Hello, my name's Dave Henry, and about 15 months ago, I started this YouTube channel looking at building an 8-bit micro on breadboards. This was based on a project that I did a long time ago when I was at school, where I basically built NanoComp on PCB, which this is the keypad with the LED display. And then there was also then a CPU board and the memory ROM and a PIA board. So when I found this up in the attic over the COVID lockdowns, I thought, should I try and make this on breadboard? And so what we've ended up doing over the last 15 months is quite a number of videos. And if I just show you how far we've got. So this is the picture of the NanoComp project as it was at the end of the last video, where we fixed the video snow interference on the video controller. So if I just take you through the main blocks of the project, this is now on about 18 breadboards and 18 bus bars, which are used for the bus signals. So we started with the CPU clock and buffers down on the right here. We then went on to add ROM, RAM, and an address decoder. Added then a serial port and a peripheral interface adapter. The serial port uses a USB to serial converter that can plug into a modern PC. And the peripheral interface adapter was used to drive the LED 7-segment display and the keypad. And the NanoComp ROM would actually scan the keypad and handle the display and would give us a basic operating system to allow us to load and save programs, inspect memory, set breakpoints and things like that. We then went on to improve the power distribution. As the project grew, the voltages across the boards by daisy chaining the power was starting to become a problem. So by improving the power distribution, we improved the stability of the project. And then the majority of the last sort of 12, 15 months has been with the VGA video controller. We've developed a VGA compatible video card, which is capable of driving modern LCD monitors, initially with 80 characters by 30 lines of 16 colors, then went on to high resolution 2-color graphics, where we use this for a Lunar Lander game. Then the 320 by 200 256 color graphics allowed us to show the Doom startup image. And this is from a palette of 262,000 colors, such as the VGA standard. I later found out that there was actually a little known graphics standard introduced by IBM shortly before VGA became generally accepted across all computers, known as MCGA. The last two modes here are actually compatible with this standard, and this will be important when we come to look at running DOS software, perhaps in future videos. Then added a PS2 keyboard, so this allowed us to plug in a standard PS2 keyboard, sound and joystick adapter, so at least we could do some basic sounds, and then managed to get a modern SATA hard drive with an appropriate IDE adapter to then talk to a hard disk controller, and we're able to read the Doom image off of the hard disk and show that on the display. If we just take a look at the original article, so this was in Wireless World magazine in July 1981, and it was about a 5 or 6 page article following on from one that was done in January on the 6802 Motorola CPU. And the schematic for this was fairly straightforward. It consists of only about 8 chips to build the whole computer. Obviously, the design we have with the video controller and everything else is a lot more complex than this, but the basic NanoComp is possible to build with 8 chips, and that's with the 1K of RAM being provided by 2 1K by 4-bit chips here. So in fact, you could do this with just 7 chips. The most important bit was the monitor ROM here, which managed the keypad and the 7-segment display. And I had a copy of this from the original project, which I ordered back in 1981. And I was able to reverse engineer this and disassemble it and actually reassemble this. And this has been the basis for this project all the way along. So I had some feedback on what I should do for the next project. And to cut a long story short, there were a number of processor options I was considering, including the 68000 series. For quite a few people I spoke to about this, really came back that really the Intel 8088, 8086 would probably be most of interest. So this is really the first video in the breadboarding PC 8088 series. So in this introduction, I'm just going to be covering some high level stuff. And what I am trying to do is to keep the videos to about 15 or 20 minutes. So what I'll try and do is to keep them short and then break and split these up a little bit compared to previous series of videos. So a little bit of background. Thank you for all those who subscribe. I think the number of subscribers for the Breadboarding Labs channel is now up to about 770. So thank you very much for all of those who you've stuck with me all this time. The first video I published was about August 2022, so about 15 months ago. And really what I was setting out to do is to try and build reliable electronics projects on good quality breadboards, perhaps at frequencies that the traditional advice that you might see out there would indicate that you couldn't get things to work at such high frequencies. So generally, electronics engineers advise against use of breadboards. I've seen a lot of comments where people say, oh, using breadboards, oh, you're doomed to having unreliable projects and everything else. And basically, I'm an electronics hobbyist, and I was really inspired by Ben Eater's series on YouTube, in particular his building out a processor based on basic logic gates. The advantage of using breadboards is it allows the design to evolve step by step as your understanding grows. Now, that does tend to mean that A, you never finish breadboard projects, and B, they can get a bit untidy, as you could have seen that towards the end of the Nanocomp project, the video controller was really getting quite untidy with all the wires flying everywhere and really need a bit of a sort out. I've had quite a few comments about, will I be making printed circuit boards and why don't I use PCBs? Now, I have had some experience a long time ago building PCBs, but they generally take longer and don't allow the same sort of flexibility or project evolution. So the name of the site really says everything. Breadboards is what this is about. I'm not saying I'll never create a PCB, in particular if I need adapters perhaps for higher pin chip or surface mount chips, I may need to create some PCBs at some point. And the other great thing about breadboards, it does allow you to recycle your projects. The first 6809 Nanocomp I did, I pulled it apart and I reused the majority of the components, even most of the wires. So it does allow you to recycle things which perhaps PCBs doesn't allow you to do. So what I should just do is to tackle some of the disadvantages that breadboards can have. And there are some disadvantages, I would have to admit. Probably the biggest one is that breadboards can be unreliable, but that's normally the case when you use poor quality breadboards. Unfortunately, a lot of the breadboards that you can buy online may be cheap and cheerful, but they are literally that. Now, I would say the one I've been using and the one that Ben Eater uses is the Busboard Prototype Systems. They aren't that easy to acquire, certainly in Europe, but I tend to buy in bulk from Mauser in the US. The need for using dual inline plastic chips, so the standard, you know, old-fashioned chips, we can't easily use any of the surface mount devices, so PLCC, LGA, TQFP, all of these more modern layout chips. They are difficult to use unless you have appropriate adapters. Now, just turns out that I'm looking more at retro 1980s projects, so that's not really too much of an issue. And one of the other key things that I've seen for people trying to reproduce Ben's projects, pad distribution can be an issue. Now, what I have done in the breadboarding tips, I'll just quickly show you. So this is a Busboard Prototype System. This is the good quality breadboard. So I buy these in packs of 10. In my breadboarding tips, I actually cover power distribution, and in particular, we cover making some sort of power distribution connector like this using 6-pin power connectors, which then plug into that. And I've also been making quite a lot of use of these breadboard buddies. So these are Hack Modular breadboard buddies which come from Tindy. And started with these two-way ones, and so those just sort of plug in at the top of your breadboard there and avoid having to have the wires between there. And there's also now also a two-way one, so if you want two breadboards or even three breadboards. Above three breadboards, I would suggest generally you want to have a separate power feed for every three breadboards, just so that you keep the voltages in the right range. As I also suggested in those videos, you can get these little power meters. So this is a very simple a little meter. They cost about £2 or £3 from one of the suppliers I use. If you plug in this to the corner of the project that you're currently working on, it will let you know whether or not you're getting low power voltages. So these are in the breadboarding tips video, which I'll include in the description below. Also, as we saw in the photo of the completed project, that using the power bus strips for buses can be a bit cumbersome, and it's certainly something I've been looking into. So as you saw from the photo earlier, I had quite a number of these power rails joined together to make the sort of the system buses for which I would be running the data bus, address bus, and various other control signals. And this works great when you're starting on smaller projects, but it does start to get a bit cumbersome as things increase in size. So what I have been looking at doing is the later stages of this project, once we outgrow the power rail sort of buses, what I've been looking at doing is I've got this sort of wide, almost 8-inch wide strip board, which has got, I think, 78 tracks on it. And what I've been looking to do is to use the sort of 0.1-inch connectors. I can fit up to 78 up there, probably start with 40 to start with. If you then use DuPont cables, so the ribbon connectors with a different plugs in one end that can go into the breadboard, and these can go into sockets. And in fact, what I've shown in some of the earlier videos is one of the tips that one of the viewers provided was replacing the individual connectors on the end and getting these sort of crimp housings. These are eight-way ones I've got. I've got a variety of these. And what you can do is to replace the individual ones here and perhaps put them into blocks of eight, and also do the sockets as well. And then that makes it much easier to plug into these types of things, and will also hopefully make things more reliable. So when I get to the later stages of this project, I plan to switch over from using the sort of the power bus bars like this and to move over to this. And as I've shown in that sequence, that using the DuPont ribbon cables with these eight sort of pin shells, you could, there's 4-pin shells and 12-pin shells, but generally I've found doing things in eight seems to work quite well. So the IBM PC was released in October 1981, and the main thing about the original PC is it didn't use the 8086 processor, it used the Intel 8088 processor. Internally, this is identical between the two, but the main simplification was that the 8088 talked to the outside world over an 8-bit data bus versus a 16-bit bus for the 8086, and that made it a lot easier and cheaper to build with the legacy components. In particular, for building on breadboard, then dealing with an 8-bit data bus is much easier than dealing with 16 bits. There are a number of 8086 breadboard projects out there. One of the ones I've included the link there. If people are aware of any others, then please let me know. So this series is quite interesting, and I've watched all of this. This really covers a lot of the technical low-level basics of how all these bits work, but doesn't really sort of build into a working PC. It produces a working computer, but not as much as one that's capable of actually running, say, MS-DOS or early versions of Windows. So if people are aware of any projects, then please put in the comments below. So what I plan to do is to build a breadboard PC using the Intel 8088, and really will be a PCXT hybrid. So I plan to try and get, from an operating system point of view, run an early version of MS-DOS, probably MS-DOS 3.3 or PC-DOS 2.11. You really need MS-DOS 3.3 to use high-density floppy disks, and you certainly need PC-DOS 2 upwards to use a hard drive. I'm going to start with a monochrome display adapter, so the MDA adapter. That's the basic 80 by 25 display. And in this particular case, I will be using it for VGA output rather than the original display adapter only output to a dedicated monochrome monitor. Now, don't have access to those, so I'm going to try and make things work with modern LCD monitors. From the 1981 PC and the PCXT, which was released a year or so afterwards, we're going to be taking the clock, CPU and bus control logic, and the 8-bit ISA bus. So this was the expansion bus. You could plug in additional expansion cards. the direct memory access controller and the timer and the peripheral interface adapter port and speaker will also come from that PC. The PC80 introduced a real-time clock and also introduced dual interrupt controllers. From around 1986-87, PS2 started to be introduced, so the PS2 keyboard and mouse and the 8042 keyboard controller that we used in one of the Nanocomp videos. Trying to get a floppy disk drive and controller working, I'll be using a 3.5-inch one just because I don't have any of the old 5.25-inch ones, and in time what I'll then look to do is to produce this MCGA display adapter, so this will be producing VGA output with the same sort of capabilities that the video controller I built on the 6809 Nanocomp. Then finally, from the Compact Desk Pro 386, which was introduced around 1986, this is one of the first PCs to use IDE disks and IDE controller, so we'll be looking at trying to build an IDE disk into this as well. So why bother with a breadboard PC? Well, I've completed the Nanocomp project, so it started on the 1981 PCs with wiring pen as well. As I said, I restarted this in 2020 and published videos from last year. Now on 18 breadboards and 18 power bus rails. I've discussed the VGA compatible video that we've done, and we've shown in the earlier videos the Tetris Lunar Lander and showing the Doom startup image. I've learned a massive amount, especially about the computer video generation over that period of time. Now, I've been using PCs since probably 1987, but I've never really done much under the hood. I know how to plug in network cards and configure all the sort of expansion cards, but never really had too much to do with the low-level hardware and things like the BIOS and MS-DOS internals, for example. So I aim to try and understand as much of that by basically building it from the ground up. Also, no one else appears to have done it from what I can tell, so I'm going to have a go. I don't know how successful I will be. Based on the experience I had with the Nanocomp, sometimes some of the steps may take a little while to solve some of the problems, but hopefully, given the information that's published out there for PCB-based XT-type systems, then hopefully I should be able to do this. Experts advise against using sort of large, complex breadboard projects, but wire wrap is okay. Now, I always found this quite entertaining in that this is a picture of the original IBM PC prototype and the wire wrap board, so the top layer looks pretty neat, very neat and tidy, and you can see all the decoupling capacitors across all of the chips. But this is the underlying side of the wire wrap. Now, I know wire wrap is probably less prone to pull out by mistake, but still, to be convinced that building a wire wrap project like that is actually going to be more reliable or easier than breadboard. So what I'm planning to do is to try and build the basics of what this computer could do and do it on breadboards. So I had a look back over the videos I've recorded over the last 15 months, and the videos are very much organised by project steps, and most videos ended up being too long, generally what, 30 to 60 minutes, and even sometimes had to split into two or even three parts. And this also meant there's large gaps of many weeks between publishing new videos, and it meant also the producing these videos took quite a long time, all the editing, subtitling, reviewing. So I plan to try and keep the videos to 15 to 20 minutes maximum. I'll see my might struggle with this particular one. That will allow me to publish videos more frequently, but won't be based on completed project steps. So sometimes it will just be, you know, design, testing, fixing, for example. I do make sure all videos have been reviewed and have edited subtitles. So I recommend, really, if you want to save a bit of time, you can view most of these at 1.5x speed with subtitles, and hopefully you'll still get the meaning. You can then slow down if you need to. So here's a high-level plan. It's quite flexible, and I don't want to be tied quite so much to the project steps I had in the previous series. What I'm really going to do is, first of all, effectively build a Nanocomp 8088. So this is really to try and make a version of the computer very much like the early phases of the 6809 project, the LED display and keypad. I'm rewriting the original Nanocomp monitor in C, so it should allow me to migrate it over to the Intel platform, and then we'll add the video controller and PS2 keyboard, and I've done very similar work to that in the previous project. We'll then look at then expanding that to become a basic floppy disk-based PC running DOS, and then later extend that to add disks, a mouse, and even see if we can run up Windows 1.0 or 2.0. So thanks for watching. If you don't want to miss out on the future videos in this series, then please hit subscribe. And if you found this interesting, please hit like. It just helps to make the videos available to a wider audience. Thanks for watching.